I like the dark. It's friendly.
So I think this is the best costume for today.
Okay.
And after you kissed me, I always used to wipe my mouth. Wipe my mouth!
I'm not going to be ignored, Dan.
Hello, and welcome back to my channel, Box Office Poison. My name is Moxie McMurder, and I've been meaning to make this video for a while. Bunny Lake is Missing is one of those films that, while well known to some cinephiles, is mostly unknown in a lot of circles. I've never met anyone in person who's seen the film, and that's a real shame because, for me, it's up there with films like Psycho, Cape Fear, and Wait Until Dark in terms of old Hollywood psychological thrillers. Based on the book of the same name by Evelyn Piper, Bunny Lake is Missing was directed by Otto Preminger and released in 1965. When 4-year-old Bunny Lake goes missing after the first day at a new school, the police start to question if the little girl ever existed, and if the mother might be emotionally disturbed. Anne, an American single mother, moves to England with her 4-year-old daughter Bunny to live with her brother. She takes Bunny to her first day at a new school, and when she arrives to collect her at lunchtime, her daughter is gone. No one can remember seeing Bunny, and so after she and her brother search the school, the police are called. After some time, the inspector starts to imply that despite Anne's obvious distress, perhaps Bunny doesn't really exist. Her brother, of course, refutes this and tries his best to help her prove that the little girl does exist. This is one of those films that explored the very real experience of gaslighting, where a person is made to question their sanity in reality. And it's honestly more resonant today, I think, than it would have been at the time, now that within the culture we are more aware of gaslighting as a behaviour. From the title sequence, designed by Saul Bass, and a very creepy childlike tune, we get an idea of what to expect from the film. The paper being torn, revealing only part of what's underneath, this is a mystery with some very creepy undertones. There's something a little off about everybody in this film.
Good morning.
Well, what complaint have you got to add to the world's misery?
So you're never quite sure who the suspicion should really fall on.
Everybody's a suspect!
The secondary characters are so damn good. We have the slightly sinister Mrs. Ford, who lives above the school and who collects children's nightmares.
Bunny!
This woman is crazy!
Don't you think we all are, to one degree or another? Crazy, I mean. Especially children. Bunny!
She's delightfully kooky and seems to take delight in news of a missing child. Mr. Wilson, the lecherous landlord who has worked for the BBC, don't you know, and is played by Noel Coward in one of his last film roles, is much like Mrs. Ford. He's something of a sinister presence, but his lovey actor style is just a delight to watch, and the character really sticks in your mind.
Who are you?
Horatio Wilson. No autographs, but you may touch my garment.
Laurence Olivier is Superintendent Newhouse, who's in charge of the search for Bunny. He's another character with some quirks, and he's everything you would expect in a superintendent at the time. He's over it before he even arrives, but he's also got a slightly softer side. Even though he's not sure what to believe when it comes to the missing child, he does everything he should, but you can tell, much like everyone else, he thinks that this is a bit of a waste of time and that Bunny will eventually turn up safe and sound. It's quite jarring to see the police blithely say that the child can't have gone far, despite being missing for 3 hours. In fact, nobody seems particularly bothered by the missing child except Anne. It feels shocking by today's standards, but in the 60s, kids weren't really valued like they are today within the eyes of the law. It rings true that these cops aren't overly concerned with the whereabouts of a missing 4-year-old. And that attitude really helps you side with Anne. It's frustrating to watch these people just dismiss her concerns. It's a solid thriller with plenty of suspense and subtext to dive into, and the performances are really fantastic. I'm about to go into spoiler territory here, so this is your warning. I don't want to spoil anything for you, so if you haven't seen the film, go check it out. You will not regret it. It's a strange little gem, and it's available to stream right now on Amazon Prime in the UK. Now, if you have seen the film, let's get into it. A child gone missing is a parent's worst nightmare, and to have someone question your sanity at the same time is another nightmarish and frustrating experience. For women, not being believed is something that we're not only aware of as a possibility, but it's also something we experience within our lifetimes. So this film is tapping into more than just a simple mystery. We're supposed to question Anne's sanity and question whether Bunny really exists or is just a figment of her imagination. We, the audience, don't see Bunny until the end of the film, and so we can lean into that idea. But there's a problem when it comes to Stephen, her brother. Stephen wasn't in the book, and the addition of his character is a bit of a flaw because he adds to Anne's credibility. Without him, we could lean a little further into the idea that Anne has imagined a daughter. Stephen's obviously seen and spent time with Bunny. I haven't read the book, but apparently without his character, you're forced to spend more time with Anne, and therefore questioning her sanity is a little easier. We also see Anne putting out Bunny's things at the beginning of the film in their new flat. Her nightgown is laid out on the bed, her toothbrush is in the bathroom, only for these items to disappear later in the film. For some people, having the audience see these things stretches that suspension of disbelief a little too far. It doesn't actually bother me personally, I don't consider it to be a plot hole as such, because it's perfectly reasonable for me to assume that if someone has imagined a child, they may well buy things for that imaginary child. Something else that I think is interesting is the topic of abortion, which pops up in a scene in the pub with the inspector. He asks Anne, because she's unmarried, if she'd ever considered an abortion when she discovered she was pregnant. She admits that Stephen offered to arrange one for her, but she decided against it and kept the baby. For 1965, it's really unusual to even have the word abortion said on screen, let alone discussed in such open terms. And I always really appreciate seeing those discussions, particularly in older films. The reveal that it's Stephen who took Bunny is when the film really kicks up a notch. And I'll admit, it does lose its way a little bit in the hysteria of everything, but I quite enjoy that sudden leap into what the fuck. Stephen knocks Anne out and has her taken to a hospital, where he warns the doctor that she's been behaving strangely and is under the delusion that she has a daughter. Of course, no one questions this and Anne is admitted to the hospital. This again taps into a very real fear that still exists today, that it really doesn't take much to have a woman locked away, out of sight, out of mind. Anne manages to escape and finds her brother preparing to murder Bunny. She realizes that he's snapped and has regressed to a childhood state. She's forced to pretend that she's that childhood version of herself too, which hints at a toxic and potentially incestuous relationship between the two. Keir Dullea plays Sinister so well. His wide-eyed cold stare is genuinely chilling. The ending of the book is different to that of the film, but I haven't read the book, and it was actually really hard to find any information about the ending beyond it being different from the film. In the film, Stephen is revealed to be behind the kidnapping of Bunny because he's jealous of the attention that Anne gives her. He thinks she loves Bunny more than him. The police arrive during an increasingly manic moment on the swings in the garden, and Anne is finally able to walk away with Bunny, proving once and for all that the child is real. As a quick side note, apparently Ira Levin was supposed to write the script and he was approached. He wrote a draft, but Otto Preminger wasn't keen on his take, so it wasn't used. I would love to read that script. I love Ira Levin's writing, and this is exactly the sort of story that he would tell. I really like Bunny Lake is Missing. The world is fully fleshed out with unusual characters, and it's a well-written mystery with a lot of atmosphere, and it's a film I think more people should see. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on any new videos. and leave a comment below. Let me know if you've seen the film, if you've ever heard of it. And if you have seen it, what did you think? If you really like this video and you'd like to help support this channel, you can buy me a coffee. I'll leave the link in the description below. All caffeine is greatly appreciated. Have a great day. Stay spooky.
We're all busy little bees, full of stings, making honey day and night. Aren't we, honey?
I will go insane, and I will take you with me!
This is your life! Right here, right now!